In the early hours before dawn, the skies over Stokosantinov suddenly erupt in flames. Russian long-range cruise missiles, likely KH-101s, launch from strategic bombers, carve through Ukrainian air defenses and slam into the airbase, one of Ukraine's most important hubs for Soviet-era Su-24 bombers, recently adapted to launch Kinzhal. Satellite imagery soon confirms the impact. Scorched runways, hangars in ruins, secondary explosions from fuel and ammunition. It's one of several high-profile strikes Russia has launched against Ukrainian airfields since 2023. Others followed: Myrhorod, Konotov, Dnipro, all hit with a mix of Jiran-2 drones, ballistic Iskander missiles, and air-launched cruise missiles. But amid these high-tech and high-stakes strikes, one question continues to surface. Where is Oreshnik? Why hasn't Russia used this highly publicized battlefield network to support or direct these complex airfield attacks? To answer that, we must examine not just what Oreshnik is, but what it was designed for, and what limitations it faces on the modern battlefield. What is Oreshnik, and what it isn't? The Oreshnik system is not a missile, not a drone, and certainly not a strike weapon. It is a next-generation tactical and operational command and control platform designed to fuse battlefield intelligence from a range of sources. Drones, satellites, radio intercepts, and digital ground sensors. In short, it is the nervous system meant to tie together Russia's modern kill chain. Target acquisition, command decision, and precision strike delivery. In principle, Oreshnik allows Russian commanders to see a real-time picture of the battlefield, update strike coordinates dynamically, and assign targets to different assets, from artillery and MLRS to loitering munitions and attack drones. Reports from the front lines, particularly in Bakhmut and Avdiivka, suggest that Oreshnik has been instrumental in coordinating swarm drone attacks and correcting fire for long-range artillery. But that's the key. Oreshnik thrives in tactical environments, on or near the front lines. Striking a Ukrainian airfield located 400 to 800 kilometers deep inside contested airspace is an entirely different type of operation. What weapons has Russia used to strike airfields? Russia has, in fact, conducted numerous successful attacks on Ukrainian airbases, but not with the help of Oreshnik. Instead, it has relied on strategic strike platforms that do not require real-time battlefield integration. These include KH-101 and KH-555 air-launch cruise missiles, launched from 295MS and 2-160 bombers, flying at standoff distances far beyond Ukrainian airspace. Iskander-M and Iskander-K ballistic and cruise missiles, capable of precision strikes within 500 kilometers. Kalibr cruise missiles, launched from naval platforms in the Black Sea. Jiran-2 loitering munitions, launched in waves to overwhelm air defenses and conduct saturation strikes. All of these systems are used in a pre-planned manner, with targeting data fed into their guidance systems hours or even days before launch. They do not depend on real-time correction, precisely because the target area is too far and too contested for consistent digital communication. For them, the standard means of destruction is the missile of the 9K-72 R-17 complex. In modern realities, Iskander or Kinzhal. In other words, the use of Oreshnik is simply impractical for the destruction of objects such as the Staro-Konstantinov airfield. For such purposes, the use of cruise and ballistic missiles is quite sufficient. As the experience of the Russian-Ukrainian conflict shows, the KH-101, Iskander-M, and Kinzhal cope with this task perfectly. Why Oreshnik isn't used in these missions? The fundamental issue with employing Oreshnik in strikes against Ukrainian airfields boils down to technical and operational feasibility. 1. Range and communications limitations. Oreshnik was developed for integration with tactical UAVs, forward observers, and ground-based units, While it may relay satellite data, it requires robust, secure communication channels, something exceedingly difficult to maintain over enemy territory, hundreds of kilometers away, especially when Ukraine's electronic warfare systems, provided in part by NATO, are actively jamming and spoofing Russian signals. 2. High-value asset vulnerability. Deploying Oreshnik-linked assets deep into Ukrainian territory would risk detection, jamming, or interception. Using it in such operations could expose the system's data signatures, allowing Western intelligence services to study and develop countermeasures. Russia may therefore be deliberately restricting its use to low-risk, high-impact tactical zones. 3. Incompatibility with strategic weapon platforms. The KH-101 or Kalibr missiles do not receive mid-flight retargeting from ground-based systems like Oreshnik. These are fire-and-forget strategic missiles, relying on pre-programmed coordinates and onboard navigation systems, sometimes aided by satellite guidance. Unless Russia develops a real-time ISR and targeting pipeline to update missile courses mid-air, Oreshnik remains irrelevant to such missions. 4. Doctrine and risk aversion. Russian military doctrine is often conservative in deploying new systems. If a capability like Oreshnik has not been battle-hardened under extensive stress conditions, Moscow may be reluctant to expose it to the full spectrum of NATO electronic warfare and cyber capabilities. This is especially true in high-stakes, high-visibility operations such as airfield strikes.
Is Oreshnik being underutilized or reserved for the right moment? It's possible that Oreshnik is not being underutilized, but rather strategically withheld. Russia could be quietly integrating the system into a new generation of drone-based strike packages that have not yet been deployed at scale. Alternatively, Moscow may be preparing to integrate Oreshnik into hypersonic weapon platforms or satellite-guided strike systems in the future. What's clear is that Oreshnik is not a deep strike targeting tool in its current form. It is a force multiplier for tactical-level warfare, and its presence in places like Avdiivka and Chasiv-Yar has likely had more impact on daily battlefield attrition than on headline-grabbing strategic targets. Until Russia builds a robust, survivable, real-time ISR network over the entire Ukrainian battle space, something only the United States currently possesses, systems like Oreshnik will remain confined to the front lines. The question isn't whether Russia can use Oreshnik to strike Ukrainian airfields. The question is whether the system was ever designed for that role in the first place. As of now, it appears the answer is no. In the face of jamming, deep targeting challenges, and doctrinal caution, Russia continues to rely on its proven strategic missiles to do the job, leaving Oreshnik to focus on the tactical grind of positional warfare. In the next phase of the war, however, if Russia successfully integrates Oreshnik with new autonomous drones or satellite-guided strike systems, we may yet see its role evolve into something far more dangerous. Oreshnik is a powerful enabler, not a silver bullet. It plays a critical role in Russia's battlefield ecosystem, but using it to strike Ukrainian airfields involves far more than flipping a digital switch. It requires deep ISR penetration, secure communications, survivable delivery systems, and high confidence in target validity. Until Russia can align all those elements at scale, Oreshnik will remain more of a tactical force multiplier than a strategic game changer. Disclaimer: this video is intended for informational and analytical purposes only. It does not endorse any form of violence, armed conflict, or political agenda. All military assessments are based on publicly available data, open source intelligence, and expert analysis as of the publication date. The content reflects the author's interpretation and may not represent the official views of any government or organization. Viewer discretion is advised, especially for sensitive geopolitical topics.